The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Networks.
Revolution is sponsored by Bahamas Bus and Truck, the Insurance Commission of the Bahamas, Popeyes, the Ministry of Finance, Burger King, Ron's Electric Motors, Fidelity Bank Bahamas, J.S. Johnson, and Commonwealth Bank.
Good afternoon, Bahamas, and welcome to the revolution here on Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. My name is Juan McCartney. So good to have you with us. Okay, so today I had planned to do two things, but I think we're only, well, I know that we're only going to get to one of those things because I have had conversations with the people who would assist me with doing the second thing, all right? So I want to deal with, and it's probably good we're segmenting these things. So recently we had the Minister of Public Works say, recently, as on Tuesday, explained that he plans to do more demolitions of newly constructed structures in shanty towns, right? Particularly on Abaco, and he says he's getting complaints on New Providence. All right, fine. So, and we'll deal with that. We will. I'm sure you'd love to talk about it. So my question that arose from that is, okay, fine, you're going to do that. The court's clearly not going to stop you at this point. But what else is going on with Abaco? is my broader question, because I think that we talk about Abaco, and the only thing, what the fellow name? Dave called. That's not, this isn't a prompt for you to call me, Dave. All right? Dave called and talked about, oh, how, why Ellsworth Johnson should have, and remember Ellsworth Johnson was here, and one fella told me how disappointed he was in me, that I didn't grill Ellsworth Johnson on the shanty town. All right, fine. So, but we often talk about the shanty, but I don't hear nobody calling me, asking me what's going on with Abaco itself. Right? Or demanding answers with Abaco and stuff. And every time I hear this thing about these Shantown, and we had a show about this, right? Where the Haitian guy took the school bus, I don't know what type of crack he was smoking, and parked it on someone's property and thought that that would go down okay, right? And so they moved him and he's deported, all this. And I asked the question then, like, what is happening with Abaco? And so to assist me on that, because I want to speak from a place of being informed, right? Because I won't lie to you, the last information I had was from the Disaster Recovery's unaudited financial report that was tabled in the House of Assembly by the new minister, Pakeisha Parker Edgecombe, and that didn't provide me with a great deal of up-to-the-minute information. So I know that every quarter, the Disaster Recovery Authority provides an update on all the latest data and plans for the Office of the Prime Minister. All right? That's been said publicly. Now, I spoke today to John Michael Clark, who is the chairman of the board of the Disaster Recovery Authority. And I as well spoke with Kay Forbes Smith, who's head of the Disaster Recovery Authority, and managing director, I believe is the title, and they both told me they're going to get me the latest information so that we can understand what is happening on Abaco, what is the plan for Abaco moving forward, what is that going to look like, all right? Because there are two separate issues that are intersected. Imagine, if you would, a Venn diagram. Venn diagrams where you got two circles and parts of the circles intersect. So there's the Haitian issue, all right, or the shanty town building people issue that is associated with Haitian migrants, right? Now you tell me, you say to me that they're Bahamian, but 80% are Bahamian, but okay. And then there's the issue of Abaco itself, all right? And it's a Venn diagram because you can't separate the two, even though there are separate issues, right? So the historic problem of Haitians building unregulated communities and the descendants of Haitians building unregulated communities and Bahamians, again, y'all tell me they're a Bahamian, 80% are Bahamian or have some status or claim to status. The historic issue of them building their, the impact of that on Dorian, the fact that there appears to be people who were resident there now going back and building again, and the fact of a lack of what appears to be resources and boots on the ground in Abaco, they're being all intertwined and meshed together, and I don't know that we're looking at it with clear eyes, all right? So Kay Forbes Smith and John Michael Clark both said they're going to give me the latest information. I want to be fair to them and give them an opportunity to provide that for me. And so we will hopefully speak with them tomorrow, if not tomorrow. Well, I'm going to speak with them today after the show, and we'll see if we can get them on a show tomorrow. But if not, we're going to figure out where we're going with Abaco, because I can't just ignore it now. It's been long enough, right? So it's a few months shy of 2 years, right? 5 months shy of 2 years. So we need to understand what's happening on Abaco. But in the interim, let's deal with Bannister, the shanty town, the Haitians, right? Okay, so Bannister said outside cabinet on Tuesday that they are going to go ahead and demolish more of the newly built structures and the shanty town known as the farm, all right? And they're also going to go ahead and do some stuff on New Providence, where he claimed that they're getting increased problems. Now, Let me say this, and so let me make this pellucidly clear so I don't have to become overly irritated today. I don't support people building shanty towns. I don't support people building unregulated buildings or communities. I don't support anything that is associated with it. I don't support illegal migration, all right? If I did, I would say that, and I would mean it, and likely nothing you say would be able to dissuade me from it, all right? But I don't support it. So please, 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 so that we have a civil conversation, don't mix me up. Don't get me confused with anybody else, all right? I do think the shantytowns are a problem. The illegal immigration is a problem. All right? That's my position on it. All right? So, having said that, I don't think the government, the Minnis administration, is A, serious about regulating all communities. And I don't think that this thrust of talking about Haiti and shantytowns is anything more than political posturing. Okay? So I don't think they're serious. I don't think they're serious about illegal immigration. All right. I don't think they're serious about people who are undocumented. If you were, you would have proposed solutions. All right. Now, we had a Nationality, Immigration, and Asylum Act drafted, overseen by Dame Anita Allen, former president of the Court of Appeal, now the Law Reform Commissioner. We had extensive conversations about how Dame Anita assiduously navigated the Constitution in order to put forward proposed solutions. We cannot run a country where we have unknown, untold, uncounted thousands of people who were born here, who've lived here, who do not have status. You can't run a country effectively like this. Unless you think how it's going so far has been a smashing success. That bill, containing some controversial elements, was then sent back to be redrafted. That was 3 years ago. Almost 3 years ago, I believe it was. How is it? Over two. It was more than 2 years ago, not quite three. You're not serious about this, right? I could tell when you're not serious. I know when you're not serious, right? I know what you're serious about and what you're not serious about. Because what you're serious about, is you go do it. You go get it done, right? So you're not serious about the Integrity Commission bill, right? That lingered. You're not serious about the Freedom of Information thing, right? That's just trying to pretty up something that you don't want to look like you fell totally flat on. You're not serious about local government. You know, you promised it, right? You're not serious. And so I would like for the politicians to stop riling us up, playing like they're serious about a real issue. All right? That's the first thing. The second thing is, if we're going to have a conversation about following the law, if we do have human rights activists in the country who are pointing out to the United Nations that they believe that the government of the Bahamas is targeting what they call ethnic communities, and the United Nations has a certain response, then the least you could do is be measured in your response to that. All right? To say that, you got to ask yourself a question. Whether, if we don't do this, the Bahamas is going to become like Haiti. His direct quote is, "It has come to a point where we have to decide whether we're going to have a society like the Bahamas or if we're going to have a society like Haiti." And if any of you have been to Haiti, you would see what happens there. Dirt, garbage, shanty houses all over the place. We have to decide if that's what we want. And if we want that, then we have to decide that we're going to take a stance in the interest of our country. So I'm just carrying out my job based on the Bahamas. All right? Says, if those folks want to make a statement about the Bahamas, then I think as a country, as we are deporting people, if they want them to come to their neighborhood and put a shanty town in their neighborhood, that's what you should ask them. How would they feel if their neighborhood, if in their neighborhood there were a shanty town with feces going in the groundwater with potential for people to get sick with all the other challenges, where you go on your land and somebody's already there putting up a shanty house? I'd like you to ask them these questions when they raise these issues about the Bahamas, because we're just trying to live with law and order, and we're just trying to protect the health and well-being of the Bahamas. All right, so again, you're a leader in this country. You're the deputy prime minister. This is that emotional, overly xenophobic response solves nothing. Because when I hear politicians talking, right, I try to figure out, where's the solution in what you're saying? Right? Where's your solution to the issue of shantytowns and the broader issue of unregulated buildings and the plethora of dilapidated, rundown structures that are unoccupied, falling to pieces, that also propose public health risks that you're not addressing? Right? So within this, I see no solution. You're just pointing out what is obvious. Okay? No, I don't want to be like Haiti. Haiti is approaching failed state status quickly, right? Haiti cannot consistently maintain a president. It has one of the most corrupt political processes on earth. It has the highest amount of income inequality in this hemisphere for certain, and it is most certainly the poorest country in this region for many reasons. Port-au-Prince, other urban areas have deep-seated problems, rampant poverty. There's often political unrest and violence. No, we don't want to be like Haiti, despite the fact that not all of Haiti is covered in shanty towns, and there are some very nice parts of Haiti. Like I said, income inequality. The 1% in Haiti live great. The vast majority of other people are poor. But what about what you're saying is a solution? You're just whipping up anti-Haitian sentiment in order to deflect from the fact that you guys don't really have any solutions to this problem of people without status, to this issue of people building in unregulated communities, or, and I'm going to be fair and allow Kay Forbes Smith and John Mike Clark to say their piece, or what to do about Abaco. All I hear is emotion. right? I don't hear sensible, well thought out, strategic policy. What is the plan? What is it that we're doing? Is that this is the end result of all of this is knock down the new homes. Okay. Then what? Because all you're doing is pointing out the obvious. And I don't find it helpful. And you can talk down on Haiti all you want, although you should be more diplomatic as a representative of our nation. But I'm so curious as to what is the strategy to deal with all these issues? Because I don't think you're serious. I think you're serious about knocking down the shanty towns, and I don't want them there. But I think you're laser focused on that because you know it's politically popular. But I'm looking for beyond what's just politically popular and expedient. I'm looking for solutions to these issues. And so far, I don't see any. Now, feel free to comment as much as you'd like. But I do find that the conversation becomes circular when we do not present any sort of solution moving forward with these issues. All right, so feel free to do so. After this break, you can call me, you can text me, whatever you like.
Everyone should experience a brand new car, but not everyone can afford one. Until now, Bahamas Bus and Truck has the answer. The stylish, spacious, feature-rich yet affordable Mitsubishi Attrage. Priced at $21,900, including a 3-year warranty, why not come and experience the value that Mitsubishi has built into the Attrage today? Bahamas Bus and Truck, the country's only authorized Mitsubishi dealer. Telephone 322-1722.
When you testify in court, you're expected to tell the truth. Same goes for your insurance application form. If you don't answer every question truthfully, you could be found guilty of misrepresentation. Leaving out just one piece of information on your insurance application can lead to misrepresentation. That means your insurance company could deny your policy or refuse to pay your claim. This message was brought to you by the Insurance Commission of the Bahamas, protecting the interests of policyholders.
Back for a limited time at Popeyes. Come in and get your rippin' chicken today. Enjoy an all-white meat chicken breast partially cut into pull-apart strips, which are slow marinated in a blend of Louisiana seasoning, then hand-battered into a crispy southern breading and deep-fried. Rip this special out of any Popeyes today, along with two signature sides, a biscuit and sauce for just $7.50 VAT inclusive.
Love that chicken from Popeyes.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to The Revolution here on Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. My name is Juan McCartney. We're trying to dissect once again the shantytown problem, the issue of the Haitian community and descendants of Haitians building in these areas without permission. All right. But I'm trying to push past the emotionalism of it and try to figure out, like, what is the strategic plan here? All right. It says, hi, Juan, I'm listening to your intro about your position and can't help but smile. I know what it is to address groups of people regularly. Trust me, no matter what disclaimer you put out, the issue isn't hearing or listening as much as comprehension and interpretation of information. Prepare to be pissed off. Now, I'm not here to fight you. I'm not here to fight you. I don't. You can't make me believe I believe something I don't. Right? So I don't believe the shantytown should be there, period. Right? So, and I support the government's efforts to remove them or bring them, have them sought to be brought up to code, but I don't see them as having a strategic plan with any of this. I see them having heard a complaint, and they respond because it's politically expedient, because there's lots of stuff people complain about that I don't hear no solutions, I don't hear no action on. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution.
Good afternoon, Mr. McCartney. How are you?
I'm great. How's it going?
Okay. Can I mention something other than the shantytown?
Go for it.
Okay. I think it's important. Everyone will agree, I think, that it's important. You know the hackers that hacked the U.S. pipeline, the cyber attack?
Yeah.
What I just learned is that the hackers have demanded $5 million.
Yeah, ransom.
Yeah, they got paid. I understand they got paid.
I'm not certain. I haven't followed that closely.
For the weekend. I hear they got paid, Mr. McCartney, believe it or not.
I don't know, but that would be amazing.
I hear they got their money.
Yeah.
Biden is holding a conference in a little bit going on now. Talk about, I don't know if he's going to mention the fact that they got their money.
I'm going to research that.
They got
saved.
Fine, you find it. They got saved.
All right, excellent. All right.
And I'd also like to mention, we heard about the trillions of dollars of stimulus that the U.S. is pumping into the economy for people as relief, right?
Right.
My take is pumping money into the economy, although you say you're helping the people, that does not drive commerce.
Why
I understand
you
the
so?
People are trying to open their businesses back, and the workers are not coming to work because they're getting more money from stimulus than working.
Oh, I see what you're saying. You're saying that.
Man, I think they're inflating the economy.
Right. Well, it may not drive employment, but it certainly would probably drive commerce.
It's creating a problem for workers. People are not going back to work.
Yeah, there's an argument to be made about
they're
that.
They're making so much money.
That you would make more money to
to
stay home than to go back to work. But I think the vast majority of people would prefer to work. All right, but thanks for calling.
So far, they're not seeing that, as I understand.
Right.
I'm also watching the Middle East, what's going on with Israel and the Palestinians.
I gotta let you go, though, my brother. You're straying too far off our topic today. I'm dealing specifically with East Shinehouse today, but I appreciate you chiming in. All right, 323-6232. 325-4316 and 325-4259. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution.
Hi. Good afternoon, Juan. How are you?
I'm fine. How are you?
Good. Someone said that, you know, in these, particularly with the situation, illegal immigration and shanty towns, you should take the emotions out of it. And I agree, right? And I'm going to try to keep the emotions out of it, even though I'm a Bahamian citizen and really upset about how this matter has been handled over the past, 40, 50 years?
Yeah.
You know, we're all intelligent people. We send our children to school to get degrees, to better this country. And still we have this problem, right?
Mm-hmm.
I, for one, I don't hate anybody. But I have one country, right,
mm-hmm.
that I'm a citizen of. And I think that we could do a better job. Honestly, we have to take the emotions out of it and apply the law. I think when you have a situation that is out of control like this, you have to just apply the law on both ends.
Mm-hmm.
You apply the law on the side where Bahamians are aiding and abetting. You apply the law on the side where our borders are being breached. We don't know who's in our country. You don't know what they're bringing. You don't know where they're living. You don't know what they're doing. It's not fair on both sides.
Right.
You understand? So the law has to be applied, right?
Right.
What is happening now is that the persons that are breaching our laws by coming in illegally are being given confidence. When you see things like shanty towns being able to go from here to building up a whole village. You know, they were like, oh, you know, these people ain't checking like that. And it gives these people an incentive to come and continue to come and continue to do wrong and to continue to be lawless, right? There's so many solutions being thrown around out there. But it is up to persons that are in authority, like the government, like the opposition, like the wannabe leaders, to really come together and really put forth, not just for political reasons and winning an election, but this, put it together to try and resolve this. There's so many solutions out there. Okay, you know, you had the minister on one time, and he's been on many shows, but you never get a clear understanding of what is the plan to arrest this situation. Yes, we have all these applications out there, and it's taking forever, but why? We're intelligent people. We have a passport office that have machines that take fingerprints. Are we using that in immigration? Are we documenting? Do we have a particular department or task force that deals specifically with this issue? Because it's that important.
Yeah, we haven't been very serious about it.
Do you understand me? So when you see one, it's not people are not attacking you or other persons that are trying to think intelligently and not be emotional about it. But we as Bahamians feel like, you know, we're just being overlooked and we're just being oversensitive. It's not true. It really isn't. We, you know, the law is for everyone, right?
No, I agree.
I had a cousin, right, that had put in an application, a work permit, what do you call it, a building permit, to get a building permit, and had started their house. They didn't get approved yet. They had to break that down. Why? Because the law, listen, you put it in. It ain't approved yet.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
You're ready to bell call. That's how you get there.
Yep.
You understand me? So it's a process. And you know, we have a beautiful country, but we have to carry out the law, and we have to stop making moves based on emotions and politics. You understand me? We have a country. You understand? And when you do that, you give people confidence, and that's why they continue to come. You have persons that are aiding and abetting. They're not being punished for it. The law is not being, you don't hear about it. That needs to be, if it's happening, then the Bahamian populace need to know, listen, it needs to be put out there.
Yeah. You make some very good points. Thank you very much. I appreciate you. So let's digest. I'll get to your text, right? So let's digest the. The issues that arise. Okay, so one, this is an immigration issue because at least you would say 20%, according to the government surveys, of those living in these communities are. Don't have any status or are not Bahamian. Two, it is a housing issue because the guiding logic would be that these people cannot afford traditional housing. And it is a process issue in terms of many people who are constitutionally entitled to status have had that process linger for sometimes decades. It is a legislative issue in terms of we need legislation to clarify, as has been promised by this administration, people's status and citizenship pathways. Let me know if I'm leaving out anything else. Am I saying an immigration issue that includes enforcement? All right. And border control, apprehensions, etc. All right. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution. Hello. Good afternoon.
Hi, Juan. How you doing?
I'm great. How's it going?
You good?
Yeah, man.
Yeah, you're not leaving out anything. I think the most important issue with this is the constitutional immigration law, where we have to decide really what we are going to do when a person turns 18.
Right.
When they born here, are they going to be a citizen or not at 18 or right away?
Right.
It can be an iffy situation because what it causes is cause somebody is here vested
right.
for 18 years. And when they get educated here, you know, some get the citizenship and some don't, you know?
Right.
Those particular ones that get that citizenship are your doctors, your lawyers, your teachers, your police, defense force officers, now your politicians.
Right.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
You know, and it boils down to one simple thing, community. You know, wherever you go in this world, you have an Haitian community, Bahamian community, you know, Irish community,
right.
and that's what those shanty towns are.
Right.
You know, how could you tell somebody who rose up here, who has family still in Haiti, maybe never met them, you know, and they feel that they're entitled to citizenship based on your constitution, and then there's a gray area, you know?
Right.
I think the primary issue is that they need to deal with that constitution, man, because Finland, at a certain point, brought people up and gave them citizenships in Haiti,
yeah.
you know, and we have not done anything since then. So what do you expect some of these people to do? I don't agree with the shanty town. I don't agree with it. But if you got somebody living in the country, you know, your law say you sign on to so many treaties that say, man, you got to make sure these people got shelter, food, and education, and health care. That's what you sign on to.
I agree.
So what are we supposed to do?
You got to have a better solution than this. This isn't
exactly.
working.
Exactly.
All right. This exactly. isn't so you push the shanty down, you still have a problem with the people. So I'm trying to figure out where to go. Nobody wants the shanty town, right? No one in their right mind, right? But we got to figure out a better way to deal with it than this. But thank you so much.
Okay, sir.
All right, buddy. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution. Hello, good afternoon. No? Okay. Hello, good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Juan McCartney. How you doing, man?
I'm great. How's it going?
Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. I call in, we got folks talking about emotion. Emotion was born with a human being. It is good, yes, to take it out, but why do we have to act so different for our own things? You know, I'm trying to say is that it's our country, okay? We work hard for it, and we do what we want to do with it. But then when you've got people invading the space and then doing what they want to do, and then you're going to take it to court. You've got to have the balls to take it to court, okay? And then you got you find people in there, too, that's a part of what you want to do. Here it is. The United Nations wants us to do a certain thing with this, right? Well, you support Yemen, and you gave them money and stuff. You support Botswana. You support Italy. There's a peacekeeping force inside Palestine and Israel. You're everywhere helping other people. Why you have a different standard for the Caribbean? Why you have a different standard for this democracy? You understand me, Juan?
I hear you. Yes, I do.
Yeah, you know, it's our country, and there's some of us that really love our country.
But okay, listen. I
yeah.
hear you, right?
Uh-huh.
But what's next after we love our country and we're angry about this? What's next?
Stop those 9 boats that we bought, those on the first world boats, put them into action, the ones that are working. And if we don't have enough, buy some more. Seeing that you got money for every other thing, buy some more boats. You stop that flotilla. You knew where the marijuana boat or the cocaine boat plane was coming from the other day. Well, you find out where these boats are coming from, illegal immigrants, and you stop them. Stop using illegal immigrants to come here to have babies and then to legalize them to get votes. Okay? Thank you, Juan. Thanks for letting me share, man.
Okay. All right. So we'll drift just for a moment. I like to stay rooted in reality, but just drift for a moment on the fringes of fantasy, right? So, in our fantasy here, we are going to prevent fully, and this would be, it would be nice, but it's magical thinking, but we're going to stop fully anyone entering our borders illegally. All right? And the next part of this, maybe it could, maybe not be fantasy. The next part of it is we are going to locate and expel everyone who is here illegally and or does not have a right to be here. So that's done. All right? That's done. We're mad about that. The Haitians are coming. We stop that. We're mad about that. The Haitians are here illegally. We stop that. We kick them all out. All right. Now, we are still left, even in this fantasy, with an issue of tens of thousands of people here who don't properly have status, an issue of tens and tens of thousands of people here who apparently do not have the means to afford traditional housing as it exists, and we are still stuck with the legislative roadblocks that now exist, and we're still stuck with a Ministry of Works that does not enforce the building code uniformly throughout the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. So let's just say we got those two things that make us super angry off our plate. We still got all the rest of this to deal with. And that's why I want to push through the emotion to figure out how do we deal with this issue sensibly? Because if all we do is wallow in emotion, we'll never get anything done. All right, let's go to the text line. This says, Juan, can you please confirm if it's alleged that a... I can't confirm something that's alleged, but I don't... What you're saying, I have no idea about. This says... As an immigrant or illegal immigrant, if you cannot afford traditional housing, then return to your country of your birth to support you. Agreed. Agreed. I agree. Taxpayers from another country are not obligated to support you. It is ludicrous to believe so. I mean, I agree. We're on the same page. If you are a Bahamian, if you are a foreigner and you are not asked to come here to work by a Bahamian who applied for a work permit for you, and you find that you are unable to live a particular standard, then you should leave. I agree. All right. Agreed. Now, we're still left with everything else. I want to challenge you. I want to challenge you to let's do the work of figuring out how to better govern our nation. All right? That I want you to work. I'm challenging you. You gotta work today. All right? I know you don't want to. I know you wanna vent. I know you wanna cuss. Right? But I want you to work. So it seems like the government is damned if they do and damned if they don't. Now see, that's intellectually lazy, isn't it? Isn't it? Isn't it? The government is damned if they do or damned if they... Who are they damned by? The United Nations? Why are we worrying about them so much? I think you could have had a better response to them, but why are we worrying about... What do you mean damned if they do or damned if they don't? That doesn't mean anything, right? So you're not working, right? You're just... Use some intellectual muscle, all right? Seems like the government's damned. That's nonsensical, right? What is it that we need to do? Because we all agree, the vast majority of us, that we don't want this situation. Now, we can flail and scream and holler about it, or we could try to collectively come up with something that makes sense. I choose to try to collectively come up with something that makes sense. I can flail and holler about it, but it's not going to make it happen. All right? Like, if I'm, and my wife can tell you, right? Like, I don't do, okay, I don't do the just emotion because things don't go the way you want. I don't respond well to that, right? In all relationships I've had. So you come to me crying, I want to know, well, who died, right? Who got sick, right? And are you hurt, right? But you come to me crying, oh, this woman at work said, I don't do that, right? I do, let's, there's an issue, let's fix it. And women often, some women often get mad at men for that, right? I'm interested in dwelling in this emotional place. I want to fix this. Nah, this is a challenge that has upset you. Let's address this challenge. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution. Hello, good afternoon.
Hello, Juan.
Hey, how's it going?
Good. Solution. Mm-hmm. Operation Clean Bahamas.
Okay.
Clean country. Number one, shut the country's borders for people coming in, not tourists and that kind of thing, mm-hmm. for 5 years.
All right.
Okay?
Okay, okay. The border is currently closed to Haiti, so sure.
Well, I don't want to narrow it down to just Haiti.
Okay, everyone. Okay.
Everybody. Shut the borders down for newcomers like that for 5 years.
What about the tourists?
Hold on. Go through the entire Bahamas with a fine-tooth comb
mm-hmm.
from Freeport to Inagua in the south.
Okay.
Okay? All of the illegal immigrants that cannot measure up, go home.
Okay.
You have to go home. Okay? Everybody that has some kind of legitimate reason to stay in the country, we're going to regularize them one way or another, whether they have the right to vote or just some kind of citizenship or something without the right to vote or something of the sort.
Okay.
The excuses the competent authorities saying the 40,000 work permits that we have, we cut them down to 30. Send all of them 30,000 expats back home. We put 30,000 plus Bahamians back to work.
Okay, I appreciate that you came with solutions, my brother. I appreciate it. We're going to take a break, and we'll be back on the other side.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
Wait, you know what's going down tomorrow?
Nobody, what happening?
Joe bringing the knife to school? He could do Junior in?
For what?
Wait, he fooled with Joe girl?
Mother sick. And you know Junior don't bark down for nothing. So that means you got a big fight tomorrow.
So whose side you on?
Side? I trying to stay in school, not Simpson fan. We gotta tell somebody about this fight.
Tell somebody? I ain't no snitch. I mean cool, you know.
Wait, if you so cool, then you need to stay in school and stay out of the fight.
Yeah, but if I don't hang on Joe's side, him and he boys coming for me next.
Alright, so we definitely gotta tell somebody. We gotta prevent the fight.
What I say, I don't want nobody call me snitch.
We could just call Crime Stoppers. You could report what you know, and nobody gotta know it's you.
So how do I work?
All you gotta do is call them, or you text them through the Crack Crime Bahamas app, and nobody can know it's you.
Then the police come looking for me for more info, and when they finish with them, Joe them coming looking for me?
When you call Crime Stoppers, the calls go directly to Miami, and they don't ask nothing about you. Then if you get the pen from them, and they can claim a reward later using that same pen.
Plus, everything's scrambled, so nobody can read what you said.
Calls 328-8477 from Nassau, or 242-300-8477 from the Family Islands.
Hello, sir. Your credit card bill is due. Hello, sir. It's time for your monthly loan payment. Tired of creditors pounding at your door? Sign up for a debt consolidation loan from Fidelity Bank and consolidate your debt into one low monthly payment. What's more, you'll also earn interest on a built-in savings account. The pandemic has curbed many freedoms, but at Fidelity, our focus is to help regain your financial freedom. Visit a branch or speak to Fidelity Bank at 356-7764. COVID safety measures in place at all branches. Fidelity, we're good for you.
At Ron's Electric Motors, they repair and rewind all major brands of electric motors, including water pumps, generators, and the generator's back end, welding machines, electric lifts, air compressors, battery chargers, and more. They're equipped to handle up to 850 kilowatts and rewind up to 450 horsepower motors. They're conveniently located on the corner of Wolf and Clarence Roads and are open weekdays 8 a.m. to 5 p.m., Saturdays till noon. They offer 24 hours emergency assistance. You can reach them at 242-356-0249.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to The Revolution here on Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. My name is Juan McCartney. So good to have you with us. We're talking about the Shantytown problem and the issues of immigrants, their status, housing, health that stem from all of these things. Now, there seems to be a new wrinkle, as I listened to the news just now, where... Did you hear the Pajo people talking about what they don't know? I'm very shortly going to stop listening to these people. Like, there's too much drastic courses of action recommended for what you don't know after all this time. There's a new wrinkle where Minister of Social Services Frankie Campbell says that they're going to offer housing assistance to the people... in the people who lived in the shanty towns that they're demolishing. Okay. Regardless of whether or not they're legal, I think you guys need to maybe work through that a little more carefully. If you are not here legally, listen, if you're not here legally, you must leave. Okay? Nah. Dagestan cold-blooded. But it is what it is, right? I can give you some housing assistance at the detention center until we could get you a plane out, right? You know what my question is? If the border remains closed to Haiti, are we still repatriating people? I have to find out the answer to that. Yeah, Frankie, I don't know about that one, Frankie Campbell. I don't know about illegal people being offered... housing assistance on the Bahamian taxpayer dollar. Okay, and the second, so that part of it I don't agree with. The part of it with offering housing assistance for people who are legally here, fair enough, but where are you going to house them? Like, where on Abaco are they going to get housing? Because last I checked, there was a housing shortage on Abaco. All right. Hey, at least that's a step beyond where they were. I don't know if I can square that circle, but okay. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution.
Good day, Mr. McCartney.
Hey, how's it going?
I'm good, Mr. McCartney. Mm-hmm. I am up to my neck. How long, Mr. McCartney, we got to carry these people? And Frankie Campbell... When they had the fire in Jenny Street, did he say anything about the people in Jenny Street?
He did, yeah, he did.
Did he say anything about the people in Seven Terrace running to Fritz Lane?
No, I don't know.
Mr. McCartney, how long we have to carry these people? Several years back, this Haitian guy said that it's more than them than what of us. So you don't think they should be able to take care of their own people now? Send them back. Mr. McCartney, don't we have a song called Send Them Back? They should have had several boats waiting to put them on the boat and send them back. They can't come here and take. They don't ask, they take. They don't ask no question, they take, Mr. McCartney.
Okay.
And then what they does, they build these shanty house and then they test it, be wide open cesspit. Mr. McCartney, have a good day here.
All right. Take care now. Let's go to another phone call. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution.
Hey, good day, Juan. How are you doing?
Hey, what's happening, Anton?
Everything good, man. Very good conversation, by the way.
Thanks.
I appreciate that you... Can you hear me, Juan? I'm hearing a double talk.
I can hear you, yeah.
Okay. I appreciate that you're dissecting the various aspects of this discussion because a lot of people are confusing a lot of the issues. And we have a problem with the judiciary being disrespected by the governor of the Bahamas because even if there's an order in place and if someone contravenes that order or someone breaks the order, it's not the government's right, nor do they have the authority to be judge and executioner. They have a responsibility to uphold the law and to take that individual back to court and present the evidence and allow for the courts to determine the outcome. That is the legal way for the government to address any mishap as it relates to the laws of this country. And so for those of you, I happen to apologize, stop talking crap. But one, look, man, I was one who was listening from this morning, and I was quite disappointed in my friend Dwight, that he allowed for that very important, critical, crucial information to play after his show was completed. That information as it relates to the director of health for the World Health Organization, mm-hmm. and PAHO, who cannot support the government or any government in its effort to allow for tourists to come into the country just based on the mere fact that they had the full vaccination. That's absolute nonsense. And now you have the experts and the authorities that our health service authorities are relying on to provide them with research and direction, being the WHO and being PAHO, stating publicly to please withhold. In other words, please withhold that policy because you're going to bring great extreme dangers and compromise to your healthcare plan. Not to mention, we have not reached herd immunity in our country. And so a whole heap of people could be impacted with these new strains of COVID-19. One, we are in a dangerous place, and we are dealing with people who have no idea what they are doing, and all they are prepared to do is claim glory when something good happens and make excuses for all the rest of their 99% of failures. Thank you for the opportunity. God rescue us from these people, please.
All right. Thanks, Anton. I'm going to stop listening to PAHO real soon. I won't lie to you. I know that, you know, oh, that sounds reckless. They're starting to get on my nerves now. That's a B with the allowing people in without the tests. Well, I can put it to you like this, right? My threshold for caring was as long as the school stayed open. So the school closed. So y'all do what y'all want, eh? Work it out. I can deal with me. All right, y'all work it out. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution.
Good afternoon, Mr. McCartney. How are you?
Hey, I'm good, man. How's it going?
All right, thank God for the gift of life. Now I agree with what you said. I second the motion. But you, if you are illegal, you must go back to homeland, regardless of what nation you're from.
Yeah, you go. We can house you at a detention center, feed you, make sure you're safe, and then you go back.
Huh?
I say we can let you go to the detention center, see the magistrate, make sure you're safe and clothed and have shelter, and then you go back.
Go back to your homeland.
Right.
You regardless of what nation you come from.
Yeah, right.
Thanks for taking my call. Have a blessed and safe day.
No problem. No. I mean, I can't go in nobody. I mean, I does it work like that other places? I don't understand. Is that, are we following a model somewhere else? They do that? They find you there illegally and they give you housing assistance to live somewhere? Or do they send you to the court, ICE, or whatever it is? Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution.
Yes, good afternoon, Juan. C. Allen Johnson.
Hey, what's happening?
Hi, Juan. Yeah, today I'm calling in as the leader of the United Democratic Party concerning policy and legislative agenda.
Okay.
You mentioned some things concerning how to solve these issues.
Mm-hmm.
Being a political party that focused on 21st century enhanced solutions, if we were to adopt some positions, we can solve these. Let's first talk about the issue concerning the tens of thousands of individuals waiting for processing. This is not a new position, but this is one expressed by the former leader, Mr. Gregory Moss, and concerning the using a technological enhancement of the immigration system to resolve this issue.
Right.
One of those was simply to put to where every Bahamian is given a ID identification system, a government identification, which the government has actually mandated during this COVID affair. And so we have spent billions of dollars concerning digitization, but this may require some enhanced various areas. I know of a company that's waiting to be paid right now by government that has done majority of the digitization work. They've been just waiting for final payment for about 10 years now. But once the ID system is in place, you'll also require, I'm going to speak to this blended, not to take up much of your time, you require that anybody who is employed in the Bahamas, Bahamian or otherwise, go through an identification verification system for employment. the laws that exist as it stands right now, where there's a penalty for hiring somebody illegally, can also be enhanced to simply subject to verification. So now you have the individuals that are subject that need to have a government ID, which will require them to, whether it be a driver's license or we issue another just ID system or something of that sort. We could set an age requirement, maybe 13 and above or whatever it is that you have. But now that everybody has an ID, when you are also working, you know, the ID system can also be differentiated. Like, let's use the United States have the real ID system, where if you enter the country for 1 year on the work permit in the U.S., your ID system, the real ID system, is only good for 1 year. And so, but the ID system, the beauty about it is we could have so many of them using the exact same equipment we have, because technology allows it to happen. Mm-hmm. But what also happens is that you would create a reward system, whether it be $500, $1,000, $2,000, for anybody reporting someone at work or wherever it is without authorization. Because the reason why that becomes easy to pay is because the business that do it will actually will actually be forced to pay the fine that is issued to them. Anybody entering the country at the same time, when you issue a work permit, the person applying for the work permit must show a housing contract, a lease or something of that sort, that is attached to that work permit where the person will be living. It's the same thing of any family members accompanies them to the Bahamas. They will also show that they have the resources or whatever to take care of them. If children come attached to them, they will also show that they have the ability to pay for schooling. We are guaranteed by the international agreement access to, not to provide it for. We're not going to prevent them access. And so when you talk about the citizenship in the past, in the past, we can create an environment where we begin to seek identity. Now, it could be an amnesty system or whatever. So you come forward and you present whatever yourself, whether you're born here, et cetera.
Yes, that's what the administration had been proposing.
Right. And so, but we're not.
But has done nothing on it.
Right. We're not giving them citizenship or paperwork, though. We're simply identifying who they are to find out if they qualify.
Right.
So the amnesty doesn't move you into the system. So we will then set explicit rules for it. Now, if you look at the Constitution concerning the shall be citizenship, it also gives a caveat. So just like in other just Soleil and such just Sanguius situation, number 14 also gives us more caveat. So we can set a period of 5, 10, 15, 20 years, whatever we want to this, even for those individuals who may have some claim once we resolve it. And so we can choose how long a person is qualified, and you must meet these requirements, meaning enter into the system, meaning you must work, meaning you must provide housing authentication, you must have paid your taxes, you must pay whatever it is. A violation of any of these terms while you're pending disqualifies you. Voting for anybody who votes without being a citizenship disqualifies you permanently from ever even applying.
But you can vote without being a citizen.
No, as I'm saying, if we check the voter's roll and find that you have violated that, we will then ban you for life. Because essentially we're giving you all rights and privileges of the Bahamas except the right to vote.
Okay.
So when you violate that right, then you are basically telling us that you have no respect for whatever it is that we have given you.
No, well, I thank you, my brother, but actually...
Let me end this one piece here, the housing thing. Essentially, we have a housing crisis in the Bahamas, and there's some shanty town environments, and we can look across the Bahamas. The problem is if we begin to look at the Bahamas as an economic model, and this is where our release will come, it will show you where we can build those 20, 30, 40,000 homes at literally no cost to the government or to the people for which we're giving those homes, because the Bahamas is a brand. We just have to begin to think of it in a 21st century economic model that takes into account all the digital tools and variables that exist in today. Thank you so much.
All right. Thank you, man. He gave some good input there, at least you're thinking. The housing thing is very interesting because we do have a shortage of affordable housing, and we can use the Haitian labor, because my understanding is we also have a construction labor shortage, all right? And we could encourage legal migration from Haiti, because they have a large labor force, right? Now, you're going to say, well, oh, you kill all the work permit. All right, y'all coming to do farm work. Y'all going to go do landscaping work in the sun. Then, all right, then. All right. If you could do it, then ain't nobody going to act. You know, okay. You saying you could do it. There's enough of y'all who willing to do it for the pay that's currently out there on the market that we don't need nobody else to come do it. Then okay, if that's what you're saying. I don't believe that. But if that's what you're saying, then okay. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution.
Hey, everyone. What's up, my brother?
Hey, right here, buddy.
All is well?
Yes, sir.
The UN, I heard a gentleman allude to something on your first half of your show when he's speaking about the UN.
Mm-hmm.
But what I don't, I mean, I do understand. I like to say what I don't understand. I like to use that hypothetically, is because the UN is worldwide. And they normally kick in when they feel that a country has illegal immigrants in it. They kick in to help. But what I don't understand, you have Fred Smith, you have Mr. Georges Luby, and you have Stephanie. How is it that they're not trying to provide, to come to the government or come along with UN to see how they can provide some sort of housing for them? Everyone is just bashing the government. Everybody's bashing the government. It's the PLP government after them. Everyone just bashing the government. You talk about solution, but no one is talking about how, when you knock down the house, Mr. Smith, this one for you, Mr. Fred Smith, with the greatest respect. When the government knocked down the house, instead of you going to the court but injunction, why don't you try to see which best way you can sit down with the government? With who, it doesn't matter which government, Mr. McCartney. And see which best way for those who are here legally, that you can build some sort of low-cost housing for them. And all of these Haitian pastors, with the greatest respect, y'all do that in church on Sundays. Y'all act, y'all see which best way y'all can put your heads together with the government for those who here, again, legally. Because, Mr. McCartney, I can speak hypothetically. If I decide to go and knock down every house in Pinewood Gardens, I'm only speaking this hypothetically. When I knock down them houses, Mr. McCartney, where are them people going?
Who knows?
You tell me now, when you knock down all of those houses in Abaco, right? Whether they're legal or illegal. But when you knock them down, Vaughn, you the only thing you're doing is causing it hard on, more hard on health care.
Yeah, they're just going
to...
Exactly.
Hard on. Now, yeah. Frankie Campbell, with respect to him, but Mr. McCartney, I honestly don't know who's right some of these people's speeches. But I think that if they need some advice, free of charge for me. Free of charge.
Yeah, I know. Right? Don't write. That's
how
he does.
Sense. How could you tell people, right, in the time of emergency, social service is there for everybody.
Yeah, but do it. He's saying if they're in crisis, right? But the government created the crisis.
Thank you very much. Both governments, Mr. McCartney. Let's have a conversation. Both governments. And some of you PLP people who don't like to hear it. Both governments. Because when you had Mr. Loftus-Roker was putting to try to get a grip on this illegal immigration thing, Mr. Pinland then put up, you know what, on him. The same thing with Brownville. So that's, you know, when I hear people call your talk show in particular, and they talk about, oh, the PLP, oh, the FNM, both governments are the blame, both. I support the PLP. Yes, we are the blame too. Because when we had someone there like Mr. Loftus-Roker who was doing the job, y'all didn't want that. When you had Brandel there under the air for them and he's doing the job, they didn't want it. Nah, this is what the end. You always talk about the end game, Vaughn. This the end game. Have a good day, bro.
All right, my brother. All right. So we got text messages we're going to deal with here. You know, I'm getting some solutions. You know, we're getting still a lot of emotion. I guess that accompanies it, but we're getting some solutions. This is one, I thought it was only me shook by the story on the government clearing illegal structures and compensating violators, and then Paho flip-flopping. Maybe I need to go read the full stories to make it make sense. I gotta think about that. About offering housing assistance to people who are here illegally. I gotta think about that one. That don't make sense to me, but okay. Maybe I'm not thinking clearly. Okay. It says, let people come to work, just leave their ladies at home. No kids. That's how the Emirates does it. You could do that. That's how they did it with the contract in Florida. Remember when Bahamians went and they would go in Florida. They probably lived here in Florida. But they would go and work, and then their families would stay here. Right? And there was an accommodation made. You could do that. This says, why Haiti? Why not Mexicans or some more skilled South American labor who are more skilled? Additionally, what purpose does the Haitian ambassador's office serve? Don't really help. The Haitian ambassador's office is here to serve the needs of Haitians who are in the Bahamas, as is every other foreign embassy. Why not Mexicans? I mean, because we traditionally have historic ties to Haiti. Haiti is closer, and they also have skilled labor. But if you want Mexicans to come and build affordable housing, okay. If you can show me a feasible pathway to do that. Good day, McCartney. Tell Anton go build a wall or add on to his house without a permit and see if authorities have to wait on the courts for permission to break it down. It says, Juan, the Minister of Social Services and MP for Southern Shores just lost my vote after I heard what he said on the news. He better not come around my house, fame and suffering. Y'all gonna have to find, I do believe you'll have to fine tune that policy if that is indeed the policy position of the government. It says, good afternoon. We have to start somewhere. Ask all illegal immigrants to come in and apply for status. Give a deadline and a card with the date of application. After the deadline, anyone found without that card of application will be processed and sent home. After the deadline, parents who have not applied will be sent back with their underage children. The children may, at the age of 18, return here if it is proven that they were born here. That is a plan. Thank you for offering solutions. I appreciate it. It says, Frankie Campbell is misguided. There are requirements for being served at social services, and one of them is having documentation of your status. He needs to be informed before making these broad statements. Then social services gets a bad rap when these people show up and can't be assisted, and the housing assistance that is offered is temporary for a week or two. What then after that? Yeah, I don't understand. I don't understand. I don't get it. I'm kind of dumb. Right, but I'm struggling to understand that one. Says Juan, put the light skin privilege to the test, man. Go try billing someone else country illegally and tell us how it go. I can't, you can't do nothing in nobody else country illegally. Light skin? That don't, you think they rate that? I ain't crazy, son. Good afternoon. Do Anton have a job between him and the other guy? Goes by the name of Dave. They don't give anyone else a chance. I'm so tired of hearing them. Bahamas needs to be fixed. We won't Bahamians have a chance to benefit for what we worked so hard for. Says, hi, those island people don't like Nassau people on their island. Judge Haitians, but we blessed in Nassau because we love all people. Says, hi, you know where the problem is. When you are too easy on illegal immigrants, they come into the country. It is an encouragement to the rest to come. Big facts. Okay. Says, one, my brother, number one, I'm sick of the United Nations. Number two, it makes me angry, the effort to help illegals when Bahamians suffering and that Fred Smith cares only for his people. Thank God I soon be out of here in 2 years because these people believe illegals should be legal. I can't go to Orlando and put up a shack in the bush by Disney. Yeah. But you know what? And Fred Smith does say some wild, loopy things, right? But, had you followed the law, you would not have given him an opportunity to put you through this whole process of judicial review. Because what didn't you do? What are you doing now that you didn't do? Right? You're now following the building code. You weren't doing that when you first started this exercise, and he got you. Right? You needed to tighten it up. So you in court because you didn't do what you were supposed to do. It says, Juan, please cut off Anton. Till December 31st, he's disturbed. Hell, he's Anton, man. He's all right. It says, Juan, ain't nothing else happening in Abaco, so just look over here at how I'm dealing with the shanty towns in Abaco. Am I not doing the people's work? Squirrel, right? It's a squirrel. We doing we getting stuff done. The shiny dawn. It says, Juan, I'm with you. Why are we giving housing assistance to illegal immigrants? They should be housed at the detention center. Use that housing assistance money to repatriate them. Yeah, I can't wrap my mind too tightly around that one. I try to be cold-blooded. I'm just saying. It says, Juan, I agree with some of your points, but what solution can be achieved if the Haitian government intentionally allowing their 10 million citizens to flood our country illegally? So there is no solution other than deterrent policies like Shiny Town Removal Jail and deportation. But firstly, if all 10 million Haitians decided that, or it's about 11 million or more, if all of them decided, hey, we come in, ain't nothing we could do, right? That'll be it. It'll be over. So it ain't to the extent that you're saying. This says, Juan, why does the WP seemingly have no end? What, WP, work permit? As long as one can come illegally, give and then have children, we're just circling the wagon and compounds the problem of status daily. Thousands of Bahamians are unemployed. Haiti has an appetite that we cannot continue to satiate. Immigrants looking for corn. The corn in the Bahamas barn is dwindling. Well, if you don't want the children of people who've come here illegally to be registered as Bahamians, you're going to have to change the Constitution and put that to a referendum. It says, it's good to give ideas when you're on the opposite side of the fence. A country is not built on its natives alone. It says, the solutions are to fingerprint and document now everyone from illegal migration, properly store and maintain those that are awaiting approval due to verification problems, deported to Haiti, where they are definitely citizens, illegals in shantytowns, deported Bahamians who also live in shantytowns, given notice to move, which they got notice, the law of the land applied. If they are Bahamians, they have family, so family will have to assist along with aid from social services. A moratorium put on the number of naturalization of persons from Haiti due to their population size compared to ours. These are but a few solutions, and I would say that Minister Bannister, whatever the motive, has made a stand, and you have to start somewhere to continue to say, oh, they waited too long to act, is true, but it's beside the point now. The pressing issue is that it needs to be dealt with, and now is as good a time as ever. Okay. It says, one, a big part of the illegal Haitian problem is to limit the amount of money a Haitian can send home. For example, $200 per month, only one remitter, one recipient, period. I've witnessed one Haitian with a permit sent over $6,000 U.S. to 15 different people, Western Union. And one, when we intercept these illegal Haitian sloops, instead of bringing them here, tow them back to international waters or to Haiti, start using satellite systems to locate these boats before they get in our waters. It says, lock the entire Abaco down and conduct an immigration exercise to fix the stateless problem. Create a system where you know exactly who is residing on the island. It says, idea, develop a housing program and pay these Haitians $100 plus food a week and a work permit to build several large buildings. And when buildings are finished, rent them back to said Haitians at a very low rental price. Anyone not willing to participate is sent back. Men and women can do this. All will be overseen by Bahamian contractors. Short-term solution, then repatriate Haitians who arrive from now on. That now you can't pay them less than minimum wage, legally. But a large-scale housing building project using that sort of labor is probably feasible, particularly with the needs of Abaco. Says, effective governing requires that we pass appropriate laws and put the resources to enforce them without bending to emotions. If the citizens deem the laws inappropriate, then push for them to change. I agree. Absolutely. And enforcement is a key part. It says, Juan, you forgot this is also a health issue. Yes, it's a health issue. It says, I feel like some really bad things are in the pipeline for Bahamians. That's why they want an early election. They know that they will lose the election if these things are introduced before election. Boy, I don't know. My money was on election by the summer, but I don't know. This says, hey, Juan, in addition to housing and immigration issue, it may turn into a health issue, okay, and a national security issue if this isn't well thought out and executed. Possible, possible national security issue, possible. It says, I can't believe the PLP fighting so hard to stop the government breaking down shantytowns. Anton and the PLP have no shame. It says, everyone should be more aware of ransomware and boost their antivirus software. Since 2014, ransomware has been an issue. They sent out thousands of emails a day, hoping one negligent person opens the wrong email. Have offsite backups and disaster recovery and avoid paying a ransom. Sometimes the key they pay for just has another time virus in it. I wouldn't pay it. Let me see. Good afternoon, Juan. It says, the Department of Social Services is open to everyone that needs assistance, Bahamians, residents, and undocumented migrants alike. Are you sure about that? It says, we can be simply inhumane to individuals that are deemed illegal, so we should offer them assistance until they're deported. Nonetheless, those homes needed to go. I fully support the government in this endeavor. It says, also writes, Bahamas is being completely disingenuous. Did Mr. Gibson bulldoze Shanty Downs to build Dignity Gardens and Pride Estates during the previous... I don't know, man. I'm trying to get to my texters. Juan, how are you? F&M. 6 more years, maybe 11. Okay. It says, Bahamians are renting damaged houses on the Keys to Haitian nationals. The Haitian nationals provide labor to rebuild the few homes that are being rebuilt on the Keys. Many evacuees returned to Abaco as they lost jobs during the pandemic. I could believe that. It says, hi, you think the MP's fool? They have sure pay for another year. Only Dr. Minasita Shore, no early election. We got some more, and then we got a lot of text. We're going to do this phone call, and we go take a break, and we'll try to finish the rest of our text. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution.
Hi, Mr. Juan. Hope all is good.
Hey, I'm good, yeah.
We do not need any contention in this country now or any other time. Bahamians should be first, but we all are one in humanity, which means that for too long, this situation about Asian immigrants and Bahamians and all that has been festering for too long. We need to put our heads together and make this thing. Like the person who texted in, they said, give them a certain time to become legal. And then after a certain time, then whoever comes in, they should not come in.
Yeah.
Unless they're legal. So we need to take care of the situation. Whoever got their houses got lost in the fire and all that, give them help. And then those in Abaco, oh my goodness. There are some people who have a lot of money who need to somehow help. And I know they have their taxes due, so they can't help that much. And there are some people who have a little bit of money who still help. And so therefore, who can help, please? Please help. All the best to us.
All right. Thank you. That's very compassionate of you. All I'm really getting at is let's be strategic about it, right? So now you're saying that you're going to knock down the house, but then you're going to pay for housing assistance. What are you talking about? And where are they going to go? Like, have we thought through all this? Because all I see it is being an exercise in appealing to people's anger over the shantytown issue without really trying to address this issue from a root problem, right? All right, we got to go to a break. We'll be back right after this.
In life, there are always challenges. Today, we find ourselves having to be more self-sufficient, socially aware, and technically savvy. At J.S. Johnson, we are committed to our customers by providing cost-effective insurance solutions. No matter what your insurance needs, we will always be here for you. Call 397-2100 or visit jsjohnson.com. J.S. Johnson Insurance Agents and Brokers, giving you peace of mind.
Tired of banks forcing you to use technology to bank the way they want you to? Your convenience is important. So no matter what your banking needs, Commonwealth Bank's friendly staff are always available in branch for that personal one-on-one service. But when you choose technology, our online and mobile banking app offers you state-of-the-art functionality. The choice is yours. Commonwealth Bank. Bank the way you want.
At Bahamas Bus and Truck Company Limited, we provide vehicles known for quality and durability. From the iconic Jeep Wrangler to the award-winning Grand Cherokee, we've got your everyday driver covered. For larger tasks, our Ram 1500, Mitsubishi Fuso Canter Trucks, CMC Verica Vans, and Fuso Rosa Jitneys do way more than just deliver. We even carry a wide variety of pre-owned vehicles. To keep you going, our parts, service department, and body shop can accommodate our brands and others. Call us today at 322-1722 or email info@bahamasbus.com.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
FM. Juan McCartney here with you. We're going to try to get through the remainder of our text messages if we can. But what I wanted to do today was to go beyond just the visceral and try to figure out how we could be strategic. Because and I believe if we start thinking along those lines, we'll stop allowing politicians and people who aspire to be in politics and leadership, we'll stop allowing them to play us, right? Because if you start to think, if when someone talks, you start going, okay, well, what's your strategy? Right? What's the end game? What's the plan here to get to? Do you have a place where you're trying to get to, and how are we going to get there? If we start thinking along those lines, we'll not be swayed by nonsense, you know? Everybody is going to, you know, get rich and sit back and collect checks, and, you know what I'm saying? So don't, people won't be allowed to glamour you. You'll have to say, show me your strategy, right? How do we get there? So you tell me, okay. So I go back to the little snippet of the debate I saw, the one young lady, I have to find out who she is. She said, under our plan, healthcare is free. Okay, so, you know, that as soon as you say that to me, I'm gonna stop you, right? How do you plan to achieve that in a real way? All right, now, and make me understand. Help! I need to understand you know what you're saying. I need to understand that you understand how the healthcare system currently works, what the needs are for the Bahamian people, what the funding requirements are. Don't just say that. Don't just give me that. All right? Demand more from people. And so when we start to think strategically, people just can't come say stuff and we just be like, oh, yeah, yeah, you know. We'll be smarter, we're sharper. Juan compassion. This text says, Juan, compassion is important, but only makes the problem worse. The Biden administration used compassion and made the situation worse. The real answer is in repatriation and locking down the border, but we don't want to deal with the hard solutions. Well, again, the border currently closed to Haiti, has been so for a couple of months now. This says maybe the social service minister has plans to put the illegal migrants up at the Grand Hyatt or SLS. Doubtful, but hey. Says, Juan, did the UN stop the Dominican Republic from expelling thousands of Haitians from their country that was born there but was ultra-virus to the DR way of life? Juan, Cuba is for Cubans, Jamaica is for Jamaicans. Are we a country of laws or a bleeding heart lawlessness that will change our civilized way of life? Okay. Says, some of us are hypocrites. We go to Miami and get free vaccines, even though we're immigrants in Miami. But we do not want to offer anything to the immigrants here. Juan, how about we allow the illegal immigrants farm for us at BAMSI while awaiting deportation and give them a small stipend? Well, I wouldn't have you work while you're awaiting deportation. You know what I mean? If you want to be here and you want to work here legally, right, and there's work for you, I have no problem with that. All right, zero. I have no problem. So I don't look at people and go, oh, but what are they doing now? No, if they're working, they're working. Right? If you had legal and you're working, that's fine. I feel as though if I want to go work in another country and there's work for me there and there's a process for me to go through to work there, I believe I should be able to go work there and no one run up on me with no craziness, but you don't belong here and all stuff like that. There's work for me here. I applied for the work or someone asked me to come do the work. That's perfectly fine. It says there are stipulations in the permit process and proof of housing is one aspect. The person who hires them are responsible for their housing. If they're living in Shantytown, they need to revoke the permits and send them back from where they came from. Yeah, you can't be in the Shantytown. Juan, I suggest that the government hire the people of Long Island as consultants on how to control the illegal immigration challenges. It says, great show today in regard to Frankie Campbell, Minister of Social Services, comments on providing housing assistance for folks in the illegal Shantytowns after knocking down the illegal structures. Tell Minister Frankie Campbell, as Minister of Social Services, to state to them the same thing he told the victims of the Jenny Street fire after their home have burnt down, go get insurance. I mean, he did say that they would get assistance in those Jenny Street people, though. Juan, if documents were destroyed, how do we know who's here illegally? How does the Minister of Social Services verify who should get assistance? Please don't tell us that the government has records. The Department of Immigration should have your records. It says the houses that were destroyed were vacant. What crisis? I saw people moving their stuff out. This says, hey, Juan, the government didn't go foul by enforcing the Building Code Act. They went foul by not policing the site after they clean, either by neglect or by intent. No, I mean, when they first started the exercise, that's what Fred Smith's argument was. And I can tell you, and I know of what I speak, the government went, oh, right? The attorneys for the government, the legal affairs people went, oh, right. Building code, notice. Oh. And then they started doing it, but that's how they wound up in court in the first place. It says, Bahamians on the ground have been waiting on help from social services for well over a year, but if you're a shantytown resident, legal or illegal, come one, come all, says Frankie Campbell. This is going to possibly blow up in y'all face real soon. This is, hey, Juan, the next thing you know, The Dominicans will be petitioning the UN to prevent the Royal Bahamas Defense Force from arresting them for fishing illegally in our waters. Well, listen, and I, in fairness to the UN, the UN was just saying that they should do it a different way so as not to create a problem worse than the one they're trying to solve. All right? And I got no problem with that. All right? I got no problem with you saying that. And I could say to you, well, look, I hear you. All right? We're going to go about it in this way, and we do have humane ways of dealing with this from here. Good afternoon and peace to the nation. The shantytown housing and illegal immigrant dilemma has prevailed for years under all administrations that have governed the Bahamas thus far, and it won't change until a leader comes forth to do what's in the best interest of its citizens and the preservation of the Bahamas. Like it or not, the government must operate within the Constitution and the law. This says, hi, Juan, what you're saying makes so much sense. For the life of me, I don't get why the powers that be can't see and listen to reason, no matter who says it, and put such thoughts to use. The solution can't just be tear down the structure. It's not going to solve anything. All right? Anything. It says, Juan, Russell Island near Spanish Wells is now worse off than anything in Abaco at this time. Well, I just had a gentleman call about Russell Island the other day, and he said it's not bad. This says, DPM Bannister needs to resign from his position for the distasteful and hateful remarks he made about Haiti, saying it's a place full of garbage and shantytowns. He's degrading another country and its citizens. The DPM needs to show more respect for the people and countries. He needs to resign, please. Listen, Haiti's beautiful, all right? It has deep-seated problems. There are people who live in appalling conditions, but it is a beautiful country. I'm not asking, I'm telling you, I've seen some of it. It says, one quote, get you the information, translate to nothing is happening. Juan, seriously, you're the head of the organization specifically tasked with addressing two islands impacted by Dorian. I call you and you can't give me an update. This stuff should be all over your brain. Trust me, you will get some PR nonsense. They don't look nothing like the reality on the ground. Well, we'll see. We'll hopefully, as soon as tomorrow maybe, do something on what's going on in Abaco. I think that we're just scratching the surface of these conversations. But we have to start thinking about these things in a strategic fashion. And that's what I want to do. You ever had, I don't want to keep having the same conversation without advancing. You know, I'm sure everyone knows that one person. You see them, they tell you the same story every single time you see them. Like, I don't want to keep doing that. Right? There's no value in it for me, personally, anyway. It says, Juan, why knock down the shantytown to create another problem if the people have nowhere to go and we have no housing to provide them? What was the point of the exercise? It seems we want to make the crime and welfare worse. I don't know. Like I said, it doesn't seem to be much strategy. I guess the strategy is now we'll give you housing assistance after we tear the thing down. I don't know what's going on anymore. I just live here. We got to go. Okay, thanks so much for tuning in today. We'll be back tomorrow. God spare life. You guys take care out there and have a great day, Bahamas.